Turning to the cloud. Excellent. Okay. Okay, so we're a couple minutes after the 12:45 mark. So I think we'll just get started, and then hopefully, as I'm rattling on about myself, others will show up. I'd like to welcome everyone back. This is the second portion of this year's New England Medieval Conference, which is being virtually hosted by Harvard University's Committee on Medieval Studies and the University of Massachusetts Boston. For those who were not here this morning, I'm Sean Gilsdorf, and my colleague Alex Mueller from UMass Boston. He and I work together on this program, and we're delighted you're all here. Just to recap, we are the way we've organized this. This is really meant to be, I guess, equal parts education and unburdening, a conversation about what we've done, what we have failed to do. I feel like we're in Mad Mass. And then what we think we'd like to do in the future, and sharing ideas and insights, and also sort of cautionary tales. And so this afternoon session, sessions will be two. The first is on the teaching of history during the pandemic, and what we've learned from the experience. And then when that's over, we'll have a quick break, and then we'll finish with a roundtable with all of our participants from today that Alex will be leading. That will, I think, hopefully tie together some things and also open up some new topics. Just a quick note, I'm a lecturer in medieval studies at Harvard University. I'll be chairing this session. I'm also the administrative director for the medieval studies program there. My training, I received my master's degree in medieval studies, actually. So I have the imprimatur of medieval studies in my education from the University of Toronto. I got my PhD in history at the University of Chicago. I just realized this with a bit of shock. I've been teaching for 28 years, and I have over that time taught a really broad range of classes and taught at a lot of different institutions. I've taught at U of C, I've taught at Sophia University in Tokyo, University of Richmond, Smith College, Mount Holyoke College, University of Massachusetts, and of course Harvard. Courses that really run the gamut. I've taught the traditional survey classes, I've taught Western Civ, I've taught Medieval Europe, I've taught early modern history. I've also teach seminars. I currently, kind of in my rotation, seminars on medieval queenship and female rule, a course on sex, love, and marriage in the Middle Ages. I teach medieval paleography and manuscript culture. I've recently debuted a class with a colleague in Persian studies on the medieval Alexander, which was team taught. And I've also been working increasingly in the last few years on medieval material culture, and organizing events that sort of straddle between events and pedagogy. So that's sort of where I'm coming from in this discussion. So I guess because I'm, I guess, officially an historian, I think it was made sense for me to chair this particular session. We have two really exciting colleagues here to talk with us. Both of them have, I think, some great things to teach us about teaching medieval history in general, but also about how they've pivoted, I guess, and pivoted back and are pivoting again, sort of like figure skaters on their blades. And our first speaker today is Janine Larman-Peterson. She's here with us from Marist College in Poughkeepsie, New York, where she is a professor of history, as well as the coordinator of the Medieval and Renaissance Studies program. She's also an affiliated scholar at Fordham University Center for Medieval Studies, and she's the Medieval Europe editor for the Database of Religious History, which some of you may be familiar with. This is a very large digital humanities project. Besides teaching capstone course, as well as the medieval, early modern, and modern history survey courses for the history department at Marist, Dr. Peterson offers seminars on specialized topics such as the history of witchcraft and sorcery, medieval misfits, which I think sounds super cool, medieval cultures in contact, and medieval gender and sexuality for the history department, the honors program, and the first year seminar program. In addition to serving as Marist's faculty advisor for the History Honor Society Phi Alpha Theta, she's organized three undergraduate conferences at Marist, served on the steering committee of the Hudson Valley Medieval and Early Modern Undergraduate Symposium, published several pieces on medieval studies pedagogy, which of course is the topic for today, and also produced a podcast for the Spiritual Landscapes Digital Humanities Project. So it gives me real pleasure to welcome Janine.
Thank you, Sean, and thank you everyone for organizing this conference and letting me attend as a quasi-interloper, since I'm technically in a mid-Atlantic state, but my parents live in Maine and I have family in Cape Cod, so I'm an adopted New Englander. And this morning's sessions were wonderful and very stimulating and thought-provoking, so hopefully I'll be able to add a little bit to that. And I'm going to share a screen. I'm going to focus a little bit more with my presentation on a specific assignment and the way I used to do it and the way that I do it now. But first, I thought I'd start with a little bit of context for people who are not familiar with Marist College, which should be a lot of people. You know, Poughkeepsie is known for Vassar, not for Marist, unless you're a follower of the, women's college basketball, right? So a little bit about it. So it's a comprehensive college, but it has a liberal arts core. It was religiously affiliated. It is no longer, has not been since the 60s. But there is, from that background, a core history class requirement. So every student must take a history class. And we don't have a lot of 100 level classes, actually. Most of it is 200 level. There used to be 2 history class requirement and it was dropped to 1. And so when they did that, in order to keep our numbers good, we decided that we would let, students into our 200 level classes. So 200 level classes can be 50% majors, 50% non-majors, that varies. It could be 30-70, either way. And they could be at any stage. So from first years to seniors, which means there's very different experiences, particularly with our learning management system. We use iLearn. If you have first years coming in, especially during the pandemic, they don't know how to navigate anything that we have on our platforms, whereas seniors do. So that provided to be a bit of a challenge, particularly during the pandemic. But as people said earlier, I forgot who, I apologize, but basically everybody at every level for a history class in a medieval or, early modern, 200 level survey class, they don't know so much about medieval history. I'm not quite sure what the requirements are per state, but in New York State, you get medieval history as a sophomore in high school for 2 weeks during world history. So everybody's pretty much on the same page about knowing nothing. And during the pandemic, the way that it worked in our institution was I was actually on sabbatical spring 2020, but I was unable, I research late medieval Italy, right? So clearly I was unable to go and do research and I had to cancel travel plans. And we have a branch campus in Florence, which is also where I did my initial dissertation research. And we have a freshman Florence experience where freshmen go for the first year and they had to be pulled out. And so I was called in, or I was asked if I would be willing to teach those students for the second half of the semester in an online course, because I do teach frequently a traditional asynchronous online early modern Europe course almost every summer. I've done it for 12, 14 years. And it just made sense. And so since I didn't really have anything else to do in terms of research, or was unable to do things in terms of research, I did that. And that was very simple and easy. I just adapted it and tailored it to be more specific on Florence to try and connect these students to what they had experienced before they were pulled out of Italy. And then come fall 2020 and spring 2021, where a lot of institutions went directly to online, Zoom, synchronous courses, whatever it may be, we stayed on the ground. and we went to a hybrid model. We had implemented testing on campus. 90% of our students, or 95 perhaps, live in dorms. And so that was very important to the institution to keep students on campus. And that's what they and their parents wanted. So we instituted routine testing policy and went to a hybrid format in which classes were capped at 24 students. And most classes were capped at 24 students. And we met in the classroom with half of the class each day, right? Half of the class one day a week, half of the class another, because we have 75-minute classes, so we meet twice a week. And the rest of the time, they did asynchronous online learning, right? That I would provide for them. Of course, there were many times where students ended up being in quarantine, either at home or ended up going home. So even when you were teaching in the classroom, socially distanced, masked, you would often have to Zoom in students at the same time. So you're in the classroom Zooming, kind of tied to the podium with the other half of, with whoever's left of that day's class in the classroom. And then come spring, we did the same thing. And we had required for everybody, students, faculty, and staff, required testing every 2 weeks in order to make that happen. And so that was extremely challenging, to tell you the truth. And in fact, in fall 2020, they had put a moratorium on course releases, which I was supposed to receive due to the publication of my book. And so I was teaching actually four classes that fall. And I was teaching one class fully online, asynchronous, two classes in this hybrid flex model, and a honors seminar at night, which I was able to teach in person because I was able to get a big enough classroom that would fit the 15 of us socially distanced. So I was teaching three different models in one semester for four classes. And I would not suggest that for anybody, just so you know. And then this year we're back to everybody being in the classroom. We're full classroom. Again, we're still maxed at 25, 28, but we're all masked, but it's definitely a degree of normality. We're able to do that because we required everyone to demonstrate that they had been vaccinated. So with that little bit of background, thinking about how to do what was technically during the pandemic a flipped classroom, right? Combining being in the classroom and doing stuff online at the same time. It's very difficult to do a flipped classroom in, say, one of these 200 level survey courses, which are the type that I primarily teach, especially when I was teaching medieval Europe at the time. So before the pandemic, one of the things that I would do is I incorporated creative writing group projects into my class for at least one of the assignments. As Sean, I also got my master's in medieval studies, and I also got my undergraduate BA in medieval studies. I didn't go on to I went on to get a PhD in history, medieval and cultural history, but I'm very much medieval studies trained. So I really approached the class in an interdisciplinary approach. So I had done a Center for Teaching Excellence workshop with a colleague of mine, Dr. Leah Graham, who is a poet and in the English department and, you know, teaches creative writing. And we collaborated on an article about how you can incorporate creative writing projects in a history classroom and why. And I have the reference there if anyone wants to check it out. It gives the justifications for doing so It gives a couple of different scenarios of how you can do it, the assessment, the outcome. But basically, we came up with two ways that this works for history. And one is a centripetal type of way, centripetal force, which is where you're asking students to situate things in context, get into a place, a time, an author, a text, as I have there. So for example, a just brief example of this is I've used having students read a knight's, it's the handbook for knights, right? I'm blanking on the name, excuse me. But a handbook for knights, and then we read a bunch of knights' tales, and then they have to pick out one or two values that knights were supposed to have. Look at a couple of examples of literature, stories about knights, and then create their own short tale highlighting that. So they're being asked to go back into the historical context. And then the other type, the centrifugal type, is when you connect like an enduring concern or issue that can somehow connect with a contemporary experience. So what was a value, a criticism, a issue in the Middle Ages that is still relevant, you know, scare quotes for that terrible word, but relevant today that could help connect students, help them understand both the place and time. It also helps with context, but also allows them to connect it to their own experience. So they feel more vested in and interested in the time period and the subject matter. So what I used to do, so this is before, this is just an example. I've done several things. I've done one on mystics. I've done this one on Robin Hood. I've done one on John of Plano Carpini's Mission to the Mongols. This example was the one I did just prior to the pandemic. And I have the description here, where we read the Jest of Robin Hood, one of the earliest accounts of Robin Hood that differs very greatly from later popular culture accounts. And sorry for my gratuitous pop culture picture there, but Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves is one of my faves. It had a great cast and Alan Rickman is so campy in it. It's just amazing. So we read the Jest of Robin Hood, and they have to identify a couple of critiques. And that's the basis of transporting those critiques into the modern world, right? And I have, briefly at the bottom there, how that is assessed, and I have very clear with all of these assignments, I have to be very, very, very clear about how you actually assess it. And it's assessed in three parts. So the group project itself, the actual tale, based on these three points I have in the bottom of this PowerPoint slide, on a self-reflexive assessment that each individual person has to hand in, which includes any justifications for choices they made, and also what they contributed to the group project. And I also kind of asked them to like rat on their group mates, who dropped the ball, right? And then a group presentation. And so most of it, only like one third of it, the group project as a whole is being graded on an individual basis. So there's a lot of ownership there because it's two thirds of the project is actually your own individual, what you contributed, your self-assessment and your portion of the group presentation. So this is the type of thing that I would have done before the pandemic. Then comes the pandemic, and even in having had experience teaching traditional asynchronous online courses and knowing just how difficult it is for students to keep up with it, I decided to actually go very, very, very low tech. And I think this is something that Megan, I believe, mentioned earlier. Students are not as tech savvy as we think. They could do anything with a phone, but a course management system, not so much. You know, a lot of my colleagues were incorporating all of these different platforms like Perusal, like using Slack for discussions rather than the learning management system. And I found, because I had the luxury of only teaching, you know, one course for 8 weeks online in spring 2020, and hearing feedback from students during that course and over the summer, I found that students were very, very frustrated and overwhelmed, because not only were they learning content, they were learning new technology at the same time and different technology for all of their courses. So I had toyed with the idea of still having it a group project. Of course, it's easily done, and there's been some great examples, you know, that were spoken about this morning about group projects. I decided instead to switch it into an individual project that had the same goal and outcome, but could be done individually, and also kind of give them ownership, especially for those students who were back home or in quarantine or whatever it may be, allow them to connect to, or actually who were not at home, but in a dorm or in another dorm, quarantined, not unable to actually, you know, see and communicate with anybody or their family, to have them connect to their own lived experience, but make it relevant to the Middle Ages. So what I ended up doing was moving to a individual poster presentation based on some easy, simple research. You know, neither of these projects are, you know, hard-hitting research projects. You know, they're more for a pedagogical purpose, really, rather than like a content purpose. But what I had them doing is move to research poster presentations and looking at as I have here, the vestiges, you know, like what did we learn about the Middle Ages that resonates in where you live or where you are living now in the Hudson River Valley in New York or someplace that you've been perhaps. And I went for poster presentations, A, because, you know, it's easy to do online when you have a number of students who are Zooming or whatever it may be. I could gather them, I could put them in a folder in our learning management system. Everyone could look at them before. You open a discussion forum, they can ask questions. Then you have the class, everyone says 2 minutes about their presentations, and you could work on the questions and bring those up and have discussion, right? But also it seems, at least in history, at least more in modern history, poster presentations are becoming more the norm. And with 50% or more of my students being non-majors, it's actually a skill that they need. You know, we have a lot of business majors or marketing or fashion or whatever it may be. So poster presentations are very useful for that. But again, even in history, a lot of modern historians, like the Berkshire Conference of Women Historians, you know, they've had poster presentations for over a decade now, as part of the component of the conference, right? So, and then the point is of this change was that, again, it still focuses on the goal, on something from the past that's enduring, that continues, and that you can identify and discuss. But it presents, you know, again, something that's closer to the student's experience, and, you know, makes them more vested during this time period, during the pandemic, you know, that time period, where I think students felt very, very disconnected. You know, the mental health discussion that there was in the first session was extremely interesting to me, and I'm sure we've all experienced that teaching over this past year and a half, whatever it's been. So I'll just very quickly stop sharing this and share the actual assignment itself. Sorry, this might not be ideal because it's in Word, but as you can see, it still has the components, right? They have to do the presentation, the poster presentation, and speak about it on Zoom or in the classroom, whatever the case may be. And then this self-reflexive assessment aspect of it. And I provide some possible topics, just as starting off points of what they can look at. Again, taking a very interdisciplinary approach of what people could address. I'm happy to share this after the fact if anyone would like. And then just in the interest of time, I'll stop sharing and just go back to give you a couple of, I'll go back to the PowerPoint slide, give you a couple of examples of what students came up with. Okay, so the name was scratched out, but somehow when I shared it, it didn't happen. Okay, so ignore the name. This is an anonymous student, right, who ended up, you can see the red, I tried to scratch it out, I don't know what quite happened there, but she ended up doing brewing, right, the brewing process, and she talks about both the process itself and the social aspect and how it connects to where she's from in the village of Catskill, New York. Someone else who lived in Connecticut, talked about a castle that was built there, Chrismark Castle. Actually, this is one that I did not know about. Ended up talking about, the person who constructed it and also the connection to the Middle Ages, and came up with some really interesting connections. Especially in that second paragraph, he comes up with interesting connections about how, why people are drawn to the Middle Ages and what castles signify in terms of wealth and power. But in that second paragraph, it says, it's missing what makes medieval castles so interesting and what's kept them relevant into the present day. It doesn't have a history or any hope of ever having a history, and it's like these types of insights that I found very rewarding in terms of looking at some of these. And then just the last, this scratch out worked a little bit better. Gothic architecture on Long Island, Gothic Cathedral, again, another architecture one. Again, talking about the church and the religion, a little bit less about its connection to the present day, but again, this is why, for example, the self-reflexive assessment part is so important. So I do not go over. I will stop there, but I'm happy to talk about the insights and the takeaways or whatever during that I've gotten more generally from teaching over this past year and a half, and more particularly about this assignment that I ended up focusing on during the question and answer period. So thank you for your time.
Great, thank you very much, Janine. We'll move right on to our second presentation and then we'll move into discussion. Our second speaker today is my colleague, Jesse Torgerson, who received a PhD in Byzantine history from the University of California, Berkeley in 2013. He currently is assistant professor of letters at Wesleyan University and teaches in the College of Letters, the Department of History, as well as the Medieval Studies program there. He's taught undergraduate courses, a peripatetic life like I did, UC Berkeley, San Francisco State, Diablo Valley Community College, Amherst College, and now Wesleyan. His current teaching covers the Middle Ages broadly conceived, ranging across the worlds of the Mediterranean as well as Western Europe. Recent offerings include a lecture course on the fall of Rome as a literary event, a digital humanities workshop called the Traveler's Lab, a seminar on Anna Komnena's Alexiad, and a first year composition course provocatively called Self and Other. And so I'll hand things over to Jesse.
Thanks, Sean, and thanks to you and Alex for organizing and for the invitation. It's really an honor to speak to all these people, all of you, both who are watching this now and who might watch the recording. A lot of you I've learned a lot from, so thank you in advance. All right, I'm going to try to share this. Let's see. I'm too quick. Half a second. Okay, is that viewing my presentation?
Yes.
Great. Okay. And if I move this, all right. The spaces in which we teach. When the pandemic started, I thought I was already turning myself into a digital humanist, even that I might have become one. I now know that I didn't know what such a thing meant. I thought my project-based and digital methods meant that I was ready for a pivot to online digital learning, and maybe a lot of you also thought so. This talk that I'm going to give over the next 15 minutes is my attempt to come to grips with my complete and utter error in that opinion. And this talk is my attempt to fit this pandemic pedagogy into both the larger trajectory of my vocation as a teacher and its relation to my praxis as a historian. So my understanding of what it means to make the past present, to embody the ephemera of the traces of the past in the minds and bodies of our present selves and of our students. In 2006, I made Constantinople for the first time. I do mean by that statement that in teaching Constantinople, I made it. A version of it, sure, if you like a figura, but I made it. And I'll come back to that point. In stating that in 2006, I made Constantinople for the first time, I also literally mean that I had never taught Constantinople before that time. And that when I taught Constantinople for the first time, for the students I taught, they experienced the city for the first time. And I even mean that for those who had been to Istanbul. So when I taught that class, I'd only just acquired my master's in Byzantine studies. It was only 3 years before that, that it had even occurred to me to become a Byzantinist at all. My financial and life situation had made it absolutely impossible to travel to Istanbul by that time. But no matter, I thought, be able to teach a survey of Byzantine history, even if I'd never gone to Constantinople, by going to Istanbul. But then the following exchange took place in the space of my classroom. I was describing the Bukuleon Palace in the southwest corner of the Imperial Palace complex, one of the few structures of the palace complex of Constantinople to survive in any meaningful way into our present. And I should make clear that the image that I'm showing you right now is not that palace, it's just sort of for the purposes of illustration. So a student raised their hand. Student, professor, isn't there a subway stop right there? Dramatic pause as the professor scrambles in his mind. Professor, no, look, I don't know. I've never been there. Student, you've never been to Istanbul? Ha, I know more about Constantinople than you do. That took me aback. Was that true? Professor, no, you don't. You have been to Istanbul. Student, what? That's what I just said. Istanbul, Constantinople, same place. I've been there. Professor, from the Bukuleon Palace, how do you get to Sergius and Bacchus? Student, what's that? Professor, if we go to Istanbul, you can be in charge. Here, we're studying Constantinople, and I'm going to lead the way. In 2015, I was rereading some Michel de Certeau, and I decided to make it real in my classes. I made Constantinople a place in the space of my class. I made the space of my class into a space where we could walk. And by walking that space, made Constantinople into a place that was my classroom. I did this in two ways. I had my students literally walk events like the Hodegitria procession through the space of the classroom. My students directed each other around Constantinople by directing each other around the desks and tables of our room. I also, together with them, began creating a rudimentary digital repository, and I do mean rudimentary. But these rudiments recreated the traces of the past by tracing out the past in literal clicks and drags, points and pathways through spaces in ways we could claim as analogous to a past place. These spaces we made into places out of the dirt of pixels and kilobytes were as real as the language of metaphor is real. They were as real as the photos that I had brought back from Istanbul. We turned the classroom into not just a metaphor for the past, but into an Auerbachian figura of Constantinople. We became an eschaton of the city past, one realized end out of its infinite number of possible ends. 2017. In 2017, with a new group of students, I did it again. And the figura looked much better. I assumed in 2017 that meant that it was better, more figured, more figural, and so more historical. We had made a figure that we could share, and that others could walk, or at least drag and scroll, could peregrinate through in ways we couldn't actually predict or control. So more than the static maps of my undergraduate textbooks or those of the monographs of my own graduate seminars, we had made a Constantinople that seemed historically alive and that was not just an inscribed space on a page, but was a digital place where students of the past, pilgrims of historical study, could find their own path to knowledge through digital discovery in a lived analogy of walking the great historical megalopolis. 2020. In January of 2020, we looked to walk a new and even better recreated digital city. But then we, like all of you, lost our communal space. The place we commingled and co-inhabited and relied on for the process of becoming a community, our own civitas and oikos with an oikonomia, the shared common room, was gone. As it turned out, as I learned, that communal space, the physical place, the four walls of the classroom, was actually where we did make our learning still. It still was and had been necessary for the kind of digital space we could create and walk together. On March 10th, 2020, my students and I, like you and yours, were exiled from our oikos, and so our oikonomia was destroyed, our shared economy of production, our civilization, and our destiny. My students and I were sent into monastic exile from each other, into new asceticisms that we neither chose nor created for ourselves. My students completed their space-based research projects on places and items in the city of Constantinople from within their own atomized unseen bedrooms, but only really for those atomized unseen cells. Our space was more beautiful, but it could not have the meaning that we intended. Students presented, they made their spaces not by speaking common words into common air, to have those words reverberate in their ears and be inhaled by the lungs of their fellows, and so make literally bodily present in a shared communion of pedagogy, this imagined but realized place that we were calling the past. No, they presented their presence as a presentation of past traces with the merest trace of embodied presence, a click of a finger meant a flash of a current, a whir of a server, and a ding in the recipient inbox. One more flattened digital ephemera sent and received and silently processed. In the spring of 2020, my great dream of Constantinople recreated disappeared. And I'm not actually being metaphorical. It collapsed under the weight of its own digital weightlessness. It's not that we gave up. In fact, we even tried to make it anew. As on this slide, we redrew our own map instead of borrowing a place created by another artist. But the place that we created as a digital map would not stop crashing the website that was the space it needed to inhabit. In the spring of 2020, Constantinople was reborn and immediately disappeared. It collapsed under the weight of its own digital presence. It collapsed under the literal weight of its own weightlessness. Its bytes had no body, and instead of visiting Constantinople, we instead visited our servers in Greenland and Iceland and old factory buildings in Springfield, which asserted the crushing weight of their overburdened hard drives with lag. Their lag determined and demanded that we stayed in the spinning gravitron of those hard drives in Springfield, watching its figura in the eternally spinning pinwheel of the loading web page, all of which made Hagia Sophia suddenly disappear in a destruction that was surely a figure of the collapse that wisdom tells us one day, millennia from now, must surely swallow that great and soaring cathedra. Constantinople had never been more dead. Constantinople had never been more buried under the invisible rubble of forgetfulness. Without warning, my teaching was its own apocalypse. I hadn't realized that I don't teach in spaces. My teaching is the space I teach. My lessons are fully and only not just embodied in the type of materiality I'm able to wield by articulating a domus doctrinarum and filling a materiality in which to experience them, but my lessons only are where they are. They only become, they only can be the sort of materiality into which they are put. And this materiality is then the reality which they themselves create. This is true, I'm now realizing, to the point that I am to the space, the body, that I'm given in which to teach. I now, like you, no longer from the filter of my Zoom servers, but behind the opacity of a mask, teach. I am the teacher from my mask and in my mask. Yesterday, 9 full weeks into this semester, a group of my students discovered that I have facial hair when I took off my mask to take a sip of coffee during an office hour meeting. Oh my God, professor, you have a beard? They have not been taught by these lips, by these mouth, by my face. The space that teaches them is that solid black mask and 2 glinting eyes. I had not even realized that in returning to so-called in-person pedagogy, that the teacher I am is the mask that I am wearing. So I began to wonder, who is teaching my classes? Who have my students heard? It is not the teacher who I thought I had created, the teacher who I had taught over decades to inhabit my body, whom my body had invested with a material presence, whom for the last 16 years I had habituated into this teacher face. I am the teacher that I inhabit, but it is not a self, it is not even a character that I know anymore. Learning my new embodiment means learning this new teacher. So I am teaching Constantinople once again, but once again for the first time. A different Constantinople and a different I. Really, these have always, always been our limitations, our realia, the nature of our teaching selves and the relationship of those selves to our materia. The present is more difficult, but I think that in its particular difficulties, it makes more truly present, more honestly present, what it is that we are doing and are making when we teach the past. In the past, there was an oikonomia and pedagogy, an economy of pedagogy that was so familiar that we could completely ignore the spaces in which we taught and pretend that they were only ever the places of learning. But we were not confronted with the truth that what we taught lived in these spaces. If my students cannot even see me as a fully embodied teacher, can they possibly know what I teach, the places, the objects, the people of thousands of years ago as once embodied substances, if not now exiled from these once familiar spaces, we inhabit the spaces in which we now teach as peripatetics who traverse them. We are pared down to our skeletal, ascetic, pedagogical cores. We are peregrini and peregrini, seeking learning in search of a home for instruction. But isn't that what we always pretended we were and were seeking? Maybe we have just been forced to meet our end before the time in which we had wanted to place it. We have been forced to embody the actual transience of our subjects. We now don't merely teach the traces of the past, but we figure the transience of the traces of the past that we teach. We are learning in our pandemic pedagogies to not just gesture at these limitations, but to know them and to realize them. The ways we teach make the past come alive. No, that's not right. Let me try a different path. The ways we teach make the paths in which the past is lived. The ways in which we teach are the past that we teach. I am the anxiety about the past that I teach. I am become the ephemerality of my source material. Maybe that makes me a better teacher, even though I do not know the self doing the teaching anymore. In this way, I am already my end. Even as I speak, I lag behind you. I am already the trace of the past in the present. Thanks.
Thank you, Jesse. Well, that raises both of these raise very different sorts of questions. I think what I'd like to, I have just a quick sort of observation or question for, I guess for Jesse, and then maybe Janine can pick it up. And then I just want to open up to the floor so we don't miss the chance to let everyone sort of have a discussion with the two of you about what you've described. I guess this goes to Jesse, and I'm kind of at the elegic mode in which you end makes me wonder. So where are we now? Is this Genesis or is this the Book of Revelation? Where we are, like, are we at the end of something, or is there a Genesis built into? Is this a more kind of, are we looping back and starting anew? I mean, you sort of lean heavy on the eschaton, that we're kind of at the end of a process, and I'm just kind of curious where you see it going next.
Yeah, I mean, I see it as more the need for constant radical rebeginnings, and not radical in the sense that like I'm upending everything that I'm doing, but just realizing that each semester really is a completely different challenge. You know, like we always talk about in the past, things like, you know, the students, the new students are going to sort of make things new, right? But as you were just talking about, we're now confronted with radically new students, right? We're sort of confronted with how new they are because we've never taught students like this who have been on Zoom for 2 years, who've finished their high school education on Zoom. And that, I think, requires, as everyone sort of today has talked about, sort of, you know, constant rethinking of exactly how we can meet them. So I think it's both, right? I think it's both ending things that we've been doing, or at least putting them in a box for later, and thinking about sort of new ways of starting again.
Because I think the other thing I wanted to just sort of pull out of the two of you is something that I think both of you are saying in different ways, which is the necessity of embracing the very personal quality of pedagogy, right? That paradoxically, the distancing that happened in the pandemic, whether it was from, I mean, in ways, I think the distancing, in fact, for someone like Janine is more profound in that there's this ghost of presence, right? You're teaching this class that's kind of in person, but it's never really fully in person. You know, the economia, that household, is never the same household. It's always a different cluster of students who are in there with you, and the others are exiled. And so, you know, you don't really have you have in person, but not personality and not sort of embodiment. And I think that Jesse was getting at that too. And so there's this weird way in which we become more aware through teaching on Zoom about the need to engage and the need to be with people. And I think many people have commented on that the strange ways in which in certain forms Zoom teaching made you more intimate with your students than when you'd see them every week for a couple of times and they come into the classroom. And I think this is, I'm curious about how you guys feel about that. I want to start with Janine, like how you felt about that. Like you said, you were in this odd shape. You were teaching in three utterly different modalities at the same time. It's almost like you're occupying three different sort of chronotopes, right? You're just like in three different temporalities and spaces.
Yeah, and on Zoom and off and in person and not, you know, and asynchronous and not. So just to go back to connect that actually to Jesse's point, I would agree. I don't think we have a choice except to see this as a beginning. You know, at certain points, the students do that for you, you know, and you have to adapt to them. And so since these students have been through 2 years, many of them of Zoom teaching or partly Zoom teaching, you know, now what I'm finding this semester is there's a real navigation going on between students and myself about, oh, I have a sore throat, or oh, I went home for the weekend, can I Zoom in? When we're meeting normally all in person, and the expectation is that they can Zoom in, but then that brings up issues for the classroom, you know? You have to stand at the podium. You can't write on the board as much, you know, so they could see. There's these expectations now that are changing how we have to react to it. So I would say definitely in terms of the intimacy, I have felt more intimate teaching early modern Europe, totally asynchronous, online, 8 weeks in the summer, because we have active discussion forums that have to do two posts a week. And as other people mentioned earlier in the day, discussion forums, you know, people will say what they're not comfortable saying in the classroom, you know, as long as you let them know, like, hey, be respectful, but they speak up. Whereas in the classroom, masked, it was wonderful the first few weeks, and now it's becoming, they're tired. They're not feeling it anymore, you know, with 4 or 5 weeks to go in the semester. So I think I have no answer there. That's my reaction.
Yeah. I mean, maybe respond or pursue a conversation. What you're saying reminds me of the comment you made in your, the first half of your talk about the kind of low tech approach and how effective that was, because I very much had a similar experience where the most effective thing I did was to like give up on the idea that I could lecture, and I just started doing audio podcasts and just talking them through texts, and oh my God, they loved it. And then I got emails at the end of the semester with like, why didn't you tell all the other professors to just do that? You know, I could like walk around outside and just listen, or, you know, jog and listen to you just talking to me about the Middle Ages. You know, and it was like, that was like literally the sort of like lowest tech. And it also, to connect what you're just saying, it also was both like more distant from the space that I was used to us being kind of connected in. But weirdly more like affectively connected. I never used to get like emotional about my classes. Like I'm an asshole teacher or something. I don't know. But like after this, like with this pandemic, I just started feeling like such deep kind of like emotional connection to the students. Even if, you know, because you're saying like, you know, some like the discussions online sometimes, just office hour conversations were so much more kind of focused and kind of intense about the subject material that it just became a different kind of connection, but in a sense almost a stronger connection. So, you know, a lot of what you're saying really, really echoes with my own experience, right? Even as it like in a sense more simple, in a sense more distant, on the other hand, more profound.
So do we have other questions or comments? I noticed in the chat that Laura Morreale made the point about the intimate internet, which I think is a thing that a lot of us have encountered, and it's odd, right? I mean, it seems counterintuitive. It's like saying, oh, you know, online dating is actually way cooler than seeing somebody in a bar. But I know there are people for whom that's actually true. And this goes too to, I think one of the things that I've been thinking about is in teaching the past or teaching anything is the ways that the Zoom, that this switch in modalities, it sort of opened the door to a whole class of student. I think this, you were talking about this with comments, right? That some people don't feel comfortable saying something in class, but they're very comfortable writing stuff. My wife runs into this all the time. But I think in broader terms, just about the, you know, it flipped the table in a sense in terms of learning methods. Like it enabled a certain kinds of learning styles that normally are just kind of disadvantaged in the old fashioned, especially in the small college environment, small seminar model that is the sort of that dominates, where it's you and a group of 10 people and you're really getting into it, right? Which in many ways, you know, you think about it, in fact, there's all sorts of biases built into that that have to do with learning style, but also have to do with gender, have to do with certain kinds of power dynamics. That doesn't work for everybody. And I think for a long time, we didn't have, I think this goes to your point being about being reflective, Jesse, this is a moment of sort of awareness. And I think it's been talked about multiple times today, where you say, oh, you know, I never had to think about that. That's just the way we do it, and we do it. And I think that institutions are, this is gonna be an interesting reckoning. You know, at our institute at Harvard, we were told very explicitly, you will not do hybrid classes. We are back in person and we are teaching in person. And if students can't come to class, well, then you can make some arrangements with them to sort of get some of the content, but you are not. And I think they were doing it for reasons that were not bad. I think they were actually for once in their lives thinking about us and saying, we don't want to put you in this position where you end up having to teach your class like three times because you're teaching a Zoom version and you're teaching an in-person version and you're teaching a hybrid version. And then you're teaching it again for that two guys who are in quarantine. So I think that was a well-meaning, but I think underneath it is an interesting sort of problem, right? That, well, maybe we should be, but if we are, that's a resource question, which again, nobody wants to raise. They just want to say, you know, we're going to do it one way, and why are we going to do it one way? Well, you can say it's because it's the best way, or you can say it's because it's the cheapest way.
Yeah, Janine, I'm really interested in your reflections on this, to just pick up directly on what Sean is saying, because you brought up about the, you know, the students kind of zooming in, because that's, I've had that all through the semester, right, with the sort of confliction of, right, like, oh, like you're saying, Sean, like, oh, you know, like, damn it, now I'm like, this is another thing for me to have to do. On the other hand, you're feeling ill, so you should stay at home, and you really want to be in class, so like, why am I being the kind of jerk who's kind of wants you to not, right? So, I mean, how are you processing that?
Well, we have been discouraged from, you know, from allowing students randomly to just Zoom in. I've done it a couple of times. I have been lucky in that most of the students who have asked it have asked it very close to class time. So I can conveniently ignore their emails, you know, and just basically be like, didn't get it in time, you know, sorry. But it's problematic because you're absolutely right. You feel like a jerk for doing that. Someone wants to be in class. But at the same time, it puts the other students in the classroom at a disadvantage when you can't. I'm a very physical teacher. I write on the board a lot. I use my hands a lot. I act things out. When I can't do that, that's 24 other or 25 other students in the classroom who are not getting that from me because I am teaching in this way for you, you know? So I don't know the answer. It's problematic. It's problematic. So I've been avoiding it, basically. I've been a chicken.
Other questions, comments? We're right at time, but I feel I don't want to stifle. And, you know, as I've said, we planned it. We planned with these little gaps in time in between the sessions, basically to allow this to happen. So I should, that's kind of like showing you behind the green curtain.
How's yeah. That? I mean, Sean, there's people are sort of jumping in on this subject on the chat. I don't know if we can.
Yeah, go ahead.
Jump a little bit or just. Yeah, because I mean, Miriam and Jan both had, I think, great points.
I think Jan's point is really well. That's what I was sort of driving at. I think that it raises also, and I think particularly in the question of resources and faculty time, I think this new idea like, oh, well, this is cool. Now we can offer this to students that they can be anywhere at any time and always be part of the class. And you'll just, you faculty, you'll just enable this without thinking about what's it mean to enable that. I think Janine's point about there's an ethical issue, right? There's a pedagogical ethical issue about that by doing this, it's rare that you're doing the best you can for both groups. What you're usually doing is some kind of crappy compromise that serves no one particularly well. And the person at home is not really getting a whole lot out of it either, because what they're getting is a constrained version of you trying to teach a class for a group of people in a room, almost like they're interlopers. I've been part of a class, and Lydia's been coming to it too. We've been a seminar we're running, which is joint, which is hybrid. It's in Zoom and in person. And it's nobody's really happy with the way it works, because the people who are on Zoom feel really kind of cut off, and there's the lags and everything. And the people in the room aren't sure who to talk to. And so it's just this really kind of not a great solution. I confess that I find the whole hybrid idea to be sorely lacking, unless there were much, much, much more technological infrastructure built around it to make it work a lot better than it does. But I don't see any efforts on anybody's part, big pricey universities to small colleges to high schools to anybody really wanting to do that. Because I think it's a level of, I don't think anybody wants to face it.
Yeah, I think, if this goes back to the conversation that was at the end of the last session, right, about the protection of labor and time. And I think we have to be really careful about that, because our instinct is always to be generous, I think, because that's the nature of why we are all here in this profession, is because we want to sort of engage, right, and be connected to each other, to our students. And so we're always going to get sucked into that kind of humanistic instinct. One thing that I have done, because I've had this all semester, like I teach the class that I'm doing now on Constantinople is a 3 times a week class. I would say I've had more classes where there's somebody Zooming in than not. But what I've done to sort of your issue, Janine, is I've made it very clear that the class is not going to be good for you on Zoom. So I want, if you need to be on Zoom because you're in quarantine or just you're sick or whatever, you'll be able to hear. But my department bought one of these like weird, they look like IV stands, but like iPad holding like robot things. So I am lucky enough to have an iPad from Wesleyan. So I put that in the corner of the room. It's sort of pointed towards a place where I often am. and the sound is okay. So like they can participate, but I haven't had, even though they make use of it as much as I just indicated, there's definitely an interest in being there in person, right? I've also never had more than at most 2 people on, and never for what doesn't seem like to me a good reason, right? They usually are, as far as I can tell, like legitimately ill or something is going on. So I don't know, like I completely agree with the sort of question of labor, but it also seems like maybe there are ways to, I don't know, to sort of rethink the space in which we teach and to which we open up to our students without kind of going to the zone of complete hybridity and sort of MOOCization of our teaching as well.
Yeah, and then we have to wrap up, so we have a little bit of break for before the roundtable. But I want to go to something that came up in the chat that Jan said, which I think is totally true, which is this: there's this other ethical issue, which is issues of accessibility, and disability access, but also people. The pandemic is not over, and so there are students who just for being in a classroom is still a problem, right? And I think many universities I find have an infrastructure in place that claims to be thinking of these issues and accommodations, but accommodations is a code word for faculty do work that uncompensated labor. There's not really an infrastructure. There's not technology. There's not staff in place to make these things really work well. And it's again, I don't mean to be too meta here, but I mean, look at us. We're all sitting here. It's a Saturday. In November, we're all sitting here all day long, essentially doing we're doing work to make ourselves better teachers. We're basically improving our own institutions on our own time and dime. If we were in any other field, if we worked in management consulting or law or anything else, we'd all be getting paid for this. But we're not. Of course we're not, because, you know, we're suckers, frankly. I mean, also, I think we care. That's the good way of looking at it. The bad way is we're suckers. And I, you know, again, I think that these are all, I think we think more about these things and how important they are than often the institutions that are supposed to be actually, this is the level at which it's supposed to be happening. I don't think these concerns should be ones that we all have to solve as instructors. You know, we got enough on our plates. There's my diatribe. Sorry to rant, but you know, I think that this is something that's been coming out of a lot of discussions today. So sorry to carry on. I'd like to end this session now, so we have a few minutes of break. We'll come back straight at 2, and we'll hear from all of the people we've heard from today. Again, this is going to be a roundtable, fairly open-ended roundtable that Alex will be leading, where he's, I think, really kind of been trying to pull strands together from the discussions we've had so far and some of the bigger cross-connecting issues that we've been talking about. And I think really leaning heavily, I hope, on the where do we go next, which Jesse has already sort of foregrounded for us. Like, okay, this is the beginning of what, and what will that look like, and how can we make it the best thing it can be? But I want to thank both Janine and Jesse for really thoughtful and very interesting and engaging presentations. And thank you for being here. And we'll see you all in just a few minutes.
I want to begin this roundtable by offering some words of thanks. First of all, to UMass Boston and the Harvard Standing Committee on Medieval Studies for sponsoring this conference. Once again, for those that are joining late, I am Alex Mueller, one of the co-organizers of this conference with my colleague Sean Gilsdorf. And I also want to offer my additional gratitude to Miriam Pages for her service as president of the NEMC, which I guess concludes today. So congratulations, Miriam, on finishing your term. And also to the NEMC Steering Committee for their work in developing the concept for this conference, which I think you all agree has been really thrilling and inspiring and provocative in terms of thinking about our pedagogy going forward. And of course, a very special thanks go to my collaborator, Sean Gilsdorf, who has a deep well of knowledge and experience in conference organizing that I benefited enormously from. And so Sean, I just want to personally express my gratitude to you for helping me throughout this process as well. And I want to make a quick note to Lydia Shahan, the student that's also assisting us. Thank you for your support today. And finally, I want to thank the moderators for making these sessions an engaging kind of virtual reality. And of course, the panelists for their willingness to share their inspiring pedagogical work with all of us today. So let me continue by just reintroducing our panelists. Again, this is for those that haven't been at all sessions. We have with us Arthur Barr from MIT, Albert Jaurette from UMass Amherst from the teaching literature session this morning. We have Megan Cook from Colby and Eurydice Giorgentelli from Harvard from the teaching material culture session. And then Janine Peterson from Marist and Jesse Torgerson from Wesleyan from the teaching history session that just concluded. So this roundtable is an opportunity for all of us to bring the work of these sessions together and begin to develop some idea of what we might mean by a post-pandemic pedagogy. So I'm going to offer some questions for the first part of this roundtable that I formulated in response to the sessions, and then we'll open it up for some general discussion to conclude the conference. So, In looking at, I made copious notes in response to the work today, and Jesse was really helpful for me in kind of bringing things together with his focus on embodiment, because I feel like there was certainly a common thread throughout all of the sessions that essentially called attention to a recognition of our embodied selves as instructors, as teachers. This came up in different ways in different sessions. I mean, some references that come to mind, Arthur referred to coming back from an injury where you have to rebuild, retrain your muscles for instruction. So really kind of calling attention to like the ways in which the pandemic forced us to think about, we are kind of reconceiving ourselves and our bodies in these places. And also within that kind of embodied self are really what I identified as four elements that, you know, affect kind of the health and perhaps effectiveness of our teaching selves. And that is the infrastructural, the communal, the environmental, and the technological. So the infrastructural came up a number of times in terms of like support that we get or don't get within our teaching. So for example, Eurydice mentioned the digital platforms that she uses and the loss of funding that she had to go back and fight for. The communal, the desire for community that our students craved. Albert mentioned this in his presentation, the kind of craving of community that he noticed in the teaching of his asynchronous course. And then of course the environmental factors, you know, the kinds of modalities of instruction. Janine having to face the challenges of, you know, the hybrid teaching, but also just that was related to her own assignments for having students really go out and recognize and identify the medieval, you know, in the world around them, right? And then Jesse, of course, emphasized this in his own teaching, and talked about his own revelation about how we used to be able to ignore our spaces for teaching, and that the pandemic really called attention to, our recognition of how much of a role this plays in our own teaching identity. And then finally, the technological. Obviously, I mean, it may go without saying, but I mean, the kinds of technologies that we rely on in our teaching. But Megan's presentation in particular, in thinking about like how in her course, students, you know, were reflecting on how remediation operates and really causes us to really think about the ways in which we encounter text, the way we encounter material objects. And of course, that is the way that we were all encountering each other on Zoom or whatever course or whatever platform we were using. So I guess I want to open it up by, you know, just kind of thinking about those, with those topics in the air, you know, what could we mean when we refer to post-pandemic teaching? How might it differ from the teaching we did during the pandemic? How might it differ from the teaching we did before the pandemic? You know, what remains the same? What might we bring back? Will our pedagogy be forever changed? So I'd be curious to hear any of our panelists offer their thoughts on the future of teaching.
I mean, I would just throw out that I really, really appreciated the way you broke this down into the four different components. And this has kind of been at the edges of conversation over the day, but like our students have been going through some stuff vis-a-vis embodiment as well. Jesse's presentation really brought this to mind in a way that tied together some threads over the course of the day. And I think I'm just more aware of students' embodiment vis-a-vis all of these things as well, and hope that that's something that we can all collectively as a profession hold on to going forward.
Yes, I mean, I think that really resonated with me too, in that we were thinking both about, I mean, a number of you mentioned, you know, when we weren't in class with our students, we were missing that kind of intimacy with our students, right? You know, being able to connect with them, being able to sense, you know, when the conversation needed to go to a different direction. But then on the flip side of that, there's been a lot of discussion about how like Zoom and other platforms have allowed for a different kind of intimacy with students, and also, you know, breakout rooms and other kinds of, you know, technological modalities that allow students to connect with each other in ways that are perhaps a little more personal and intimate. And then finally, I mean, the other element is, and this was mentioned in Q&A, I think, by Miriam and others, that, you know, Zoom in particular, you know, it reveals our private lives, you know, both ours and our students, to everyone in that class. And I don't know, this hasn't really come up with in our discussion yet, I don't think. But I know in my case at UMass Boston, we were really encouraged, especially because our student population is we have a very high percentage of first generation college students, and a number of students who are working full-time jobs. It's primarily a commuting school. So when we transitioned to you know, online teaching, this meant that students were taking my class from their car, or, you know, like trying to work my class in during breaks at work. They were often, you know, working in grocery stores. So I often was teaching to, you know, a bunch of black boxes, right? And so it wasn't clear whether they were there. So it was both really intimate, but also the opposite at the same time. It also felt very impersonal. So I'm curious to know more. I'd like to build on this a little bit more to hear your thoughts on this kind of complication of intimacy in post-pandemic teaching.
Well, I think part of the problem is, in fact, that intimacy. I think a lot of people have talked about this. The, as you said, there's the intimacy problem of, there are things like, people like to be able to break their life up into different kinds of zones or spheres or places. You know, the notion of privacy, the notion that you have, I leave, this is part of this what I do here, and this is part of what I do here, right? And everyone always talks about it in terms of work-life balance, but of course for students, I think they have a work-life balance too. And I always got the feeling teaching in Zoom that I think we all were suffering from that collapse. That all of us, like, the, you know, all of us know, those of us who, you know, if you have a partner or don't, but, you know, you're in your house, you have your kids, if you have kids, that the collapse of those spaces into one space, so that you're never really, like, you know, normally you go to work, right? You go to work, and that spatial dislocation has a really important psychological effect. It allows you, it's a reset. It allows you to shape a set of activities and expectations and performances and habits that are spatially construed. This is, I think Jesse was getting at this in his presentation. You're kind of entering, it's like going to the theater almost, right? You're getting on stage, you're staging your life in a certain sort of way for a certain sort of group, for a certain kind of relationship, which gets really kind of ripped apart when you are just stepping from the hallway into your study, or into, for many people, just their bedroom or wherever they happen to have a space. And then are trying to, I think this is why so many of us had such problems with Zoom teaching. It was not so much that we didn't know how to teach, we couldn't teach on a screen. It's that we were in this weird moment where we weren't, like, we're doing something we shouldn't be doing. Like, I shouldn't be sitting in my, like, my bedroom at home having this engagement with students. Like, that's wrong. Like, it's the wrong script. It's like doing, I don't know, it's like some kind of avant-garde theater. Like, I'm doing Shakespeare on a subway. Like, there just seems something very wrong about it. And I think it has to do with habituation, but it also has to do with the way that we segment our lives. And I think to have that ripped away was really problematic. And I think it's caused a lot of the anxiety. It wasn't so much that we couldn't teach them, or we weren't engaged with our students, or we didn't know the material. Just like, what the hell am I doing this here? It's like you wake up, you know, having those dreams, you wake up and you're naked in the school hallway. Just, this is wrong. There's something wrong about this. And I think it's, for a lot of people, it's never really shaken off. And that's why I was actually really intrigued by Janine's experience of, in a sense, you're living in these weird kind of dual worlds when you're teaching hybrid, especially when people are zooming into a live classroom. Like, what, you know, they're sitting in their bedroom and you're meanwhile standing in a classroom at a university. And it's just very, I don't know, it just seems very, there's something uncanny about it.
And we also had to, at certain times, we went on pause because there were too many cases. So then then the hybrid would switch to Zoom, period. And so I understand what you're saying, that I'm very much a compartmentalizer. And so the shifting was difficult, fine, but also you're absolutely correct. I mean, I know I felt, especially because there were things going on in my life. So I felt I'm one of those people who will tell a lot of stories in the classroom, but never about myself. No student has ever known if I'm married, if I have kids, if I'm straight or not, or anything, you know, like that. I just keep that part of my life very separate. They know I have cats, but you know, besides that, you know, so that was difficult. But to get back, if I could just mention really briefly, because to get back to the point about moving forward, I know I had said and agreed and do agree with Jesse that post-pandemic teaching, you know, it's going to have to change. But I think one of the things that Megan said earlier during her talk about the flexibility issue, having to be flexible, it might, you know, as we discussed at the end of the last session, you know, is going to be like the huge component of post-pandemic teaching. But I also wonder if, like, now teaching in a full classroom, but we're masked, I also wonder if in some ways when we're unmasked again in a classroom together, is all this just going to go, is all of it going to go away? And we're going to go back into, you know, and we're going to go back into our old modes of teaching and students. I don't know. I think that's going to be a very interesting process when eventually, maybe, hopefully, whatever, people are maskless in a classroom again, because even how hard it is to gauge interest on Zoom, especially when it's the black boxes, it's also really hard, you know, when people have, you know, masks up to here, especially if they wear glasses, right? You have to have your mask up so they don't fog up. It's hard also to gauge and to read the room, like Arthur, I believe, was talking about earlier this morning as well. So.
Thanks, Janine. Jesse, then Arthur.
Yeah, I actually just wanted to throw this question to Megan and Eurydice, because I think comments that both of you made in your presentations that I wrote down sort of enthusiastically and frantically really, really stuck with me on this question. You know, ideas of, I mean, I think Megan, you said it explicitly, but sort of changing what it is that you're trying to get them to learn, right? And you talked, as I recall, the right, sort of like challenging the very kind of like imitatio-based pedagogy that we sort of all went through grad school on, like, well, what are we doing here? Well, you're trying to like be like them. And so, of course, then that's what I should pass on. And, you know, to me, in both of your presentations, that came out very explicitly as, you know, some of the kind of like basic content maybe has, if not sort of fundamentally changed, at least sort of shifted. So I'd be curious, you know, if both of you would be willing to return to some of those points you were making.
Yeah, if I could just answer real quickly, I've found myself over the last year and a half thinking more and more about my first year writing pedagogy. So we have a writing across the curriculum model where composition classes live in departments. And are taught generally by continuing faculty. And I had always thought of that as sort of an add-on to my teaching in medieval studies, particularly the upper level classes. But, you know, I mentioned drawing on the universal design for learning framework, the idea of backwards design. Like many of us, I have a kind of instinctive reaction to terms like learning outcomes that feel, you know, very externally imposed. But having that framework already be a part of my pedagogy, I do think has been helpful in terms of aiding me in clarifying what exactly it is I want students to take away from the class and distinguishing sort of tenor and vehicle, right? And so I think I had jumped into planning this manuscripts class without really distinguishing between form and content, and the kind of radical revisioning that I had to do when I put it online, even though it was supposed to be a digital studies class to begin with, really forced me to think about that in a way that I hadn't previously brought to a class that did draw on my graduate training in that way. Because like so many of us who teach writing intensive classes, I was not trained to do it. I learned to do it on the job. And you sort of pick things up in bits and pieces as you go. So that's what I would say. I don't know. You ready to see?
So yes, Jesse, I think my takeaway from this experience is that although I have kept, let's say, the core of my courses, that is, I have a particular material to cover, and I want them to learn a lot, and I have all these wonderful PDFs and prompts, go to the fine arts library, I have all these reserved books for you. Now I'm more keen that the students strengthen their learning agility, because I recognize that that they come from so many different kinds of spaces, thinking spaces, abilities, and also disciplines. And although before they were exactly the same kind of, we had exactly the same configuration, now have become acutely aware that this is something I have to address. So before I was terribly religious, I was saying, I always posted my PowerPoint presentations, their presentations, etc. And then the final project had always had to be an essay. And now I recognize that there are people who can express themselves in a different ways. So a student, a German student who writes for Netflix, created a play, a short play on relics of the passion, modern museums, and the murder case. Now, this was during the pandemic. This semester, I'm teaching the Crusades again, and I have said, if you would like to write poetry, a theater play, this is absolutely fine with me. So there are many different ways now to assess their ability to be part of the Middle Ages. Also, what lesson I learned from the pandemic is that I have to be terribly militant with university administrators who think so lowly of humanities and the Middle Ages. So I want to ask for more in order to be given some. So infrastructure, you mentioned, Alex, it is terribly important. And then the TFs, why TFs during the pandemic miraculously appeared responsible for smaller groups. And now we are going back to chaos. And we have to address, I don't know, 30 students and one TF. So do we offer personalized journeys, learning journeys, or really rubbish? So there are issues that we have to address, but as an educator, I became more flexible and I'm okay with this because I understand how important it is to ask the students to have their voice heard.
Thanks, Eurydice. Arthur?
Yeah, I thought that was a lovely use of the term agility by Eurydice. And I think that that distinction between strength and agility is a useful one, because I think I was trained, and certainly many of us were trained, and certainly MIT fetishizes this a certain kind of belief in rigor and strength and grit and fortitude and endurance and all of these things, right? And I don't think, you know, I don't think those are unimportant suddenly, but I think it's been proven that they are not the only important thing, and they're not, as you say, the only important modality. So that was one thing I was going to say. Going back to Janine's point about masks in the classroom, I think that is actually, for me, has been one of the major challenges of coming back to the classroom, is that I really, in a weird way, I I would so often prefer to be on Zoom actually and see their faces, paracranum in Enigmate or whatever. And I think that this is obviously part of a much broader political cultural discussion that I do not want to touch. But I think not acknowledging that there is still a sort of deep phenomenon of alienation is fruitless.
Thanks, Arthur. Sean?
Yeah, I would totally agree with that. I was at a talk last week, I guess it was, or earlier this week, and we decided that the speaker, we have this somewhat ambivalent mask policy about those kinds of things. And we just decided, given the size of the group, the size of the room and where he was sitting, that just let him take his mask off to speak. And I confess to an astonishing sense of elation almost, or really just to watch someone's face as they said these very interesting things that I was in it. My being masked was not the problem, I realized. I've always thought, oh God, I hate to be masked. And it was more, I hate to watch other people being masked and trying to communicate with them, because it's so hard to read them and to understand them and to be one with them. And just to go to a talk where that was taking place was remarkable. I mean, and it was more remarkable than I thought it was. I was just a little taken back with myself, like, God, why is this such a big deal? Because I see lots of people without masks outdoors, and I see my family without a mask. But still, it was something about that context, that I do agree that is definitely important. I also wanted to throw one thing here. I will say that this is one of those things where I found that teaching on Zoom, in a sense, made some of the things I'd already started to do before the pandemic easier. Years ago, I had stopped giving my students essays. I quit giving them the formal essay as an assignment. I just decided I was sick of them, that it was an assignment. It basically was teaching them to do something that they never, ever would do. Like writing formal literary, a former historical essay is a great thing you do if you're going to go into grad school. Maybe you're going to write articles, but not for most of the kind of writing you're actually going to do. So I'd moved away from that long ago. And I've moved much more into group-based work. I have my students are always working in collaborative groups, and I've spent a lot of time and energy and thought about coming up with ways to keep that accountable, right? So that it's not, you don't get free riders and everyone's got to pull their weight, and there's ways to do that. And I actually found in COVID that those assignments worked even better, because as I think many people have mentioned, group work in the virtual space works lots better. Like breakout rooms are so much better than trying to take your actual living class and move them around into little clusters. It's just cacophonous and awful, right? To do little breakouts, but breaking out people in Zoom is easy. And then having them work together collaboratively now with the tools we have was easy as pie. And I was using digital tools for the projects they were working on. They'd always done those before. And I just found the whole thing was just like, oh, this is great. Like, this is actually a better way to do the kinds of assignments and the kind of work I like my students to do. It actually fit in the flow of the class much better than this before it'd been kind of adjuncted to it, to the discussions we had in class. So the question, of course, then is how do we keep those positives? This goes to Alex's question about where do we go? How do we keep those positives in place? How can we keep doing that kind of work while still having that be fed by and feed into the sort of interpersonal, face-to-face kinds of environments that we also enjoy? How do you make those things work well together? I think that had been a question before COVID ever came along. But I'm kind of hoping in a sort of sneaky way that COVID can be used as a Trojan horse to get the kinds of resources and approaches in place that will allow us to do that kind of work even better. Under the cover, I guess, of COVID. Like, oh, COVID, we really need to have more sort of hybrid opportunities for online work together. So that's something I've been thinking about.
Yeah, and I want to follow up on that a little bit. And I'm thinking in particular about Albert's presentation about, changing the asynchronous course and incorporating other elements like synchronous meetings. I mean, thinking about like what Arthur was just saying about masks and in-person teaching, like there seems to be a lot of, at least among my colleagues, when we talk about like face-to-face teaching versus remote teaching, like people seem to kind of line up into either one of those categories, like, you know, like, oh, this one's better than the other. But the truth is, I think, like, at least based on what people are saying, is that, you know, there are, it's much more complex than that, right? I mean, there are great things like breakout rooms, but that may not mean that we believe that everything about Zoom teaching is great, right? And likewise, like, we may agree that you know, being in the same room with students and feeling their energy and being able to touch material objects and, you know, those things are important. We want to do those. I mean, I'm thinking about, like, what is the role of digital technology going forward? How do we create a kind of nuanced digital pedagogy that is going to, you know, really work with that tension without kind of being all one or all the other? So I don't know, Albert, it looks like you have your hand raised, but I was hoping you could weigh in on this.
There are things, there are practices that worked well for me when I changed I made all that huge effort in the summer to move to an asynchronous, basically asynchronous delivery. I thought, how could I just be doing similar things or keeping part of the technology or the ideas behind it? As you were saying, it's exactly that, right? The fact that small groups work in Zoom doesn't mean that we love Zoom, right? But there's that we learned there. So that applies to me. I see all these jokes you're making about sending students in IRL breakout rooms, like when they're physically, right? Well, I was not a huge fan of separating students in small groups. Actually, I avoided it. I preferred assigning them roles that they would know they're responsible for, and then they can prepare for and participate in class in bigger groups rather than having them separated. Well, that has changed this semester. Not only am I separating them systematically in every class, but I also keep mixing them around. And it's totally worth the couple of minutes I spend arranging them with different people over and over during the semester so that they interact. Something I really did not like doing. I did not like the dynamics of the class. Now I think it works, and it's been because of that. Another thing that worked very well was the voice threads, which is a technology that you use all the time in language teaching, language instruction. Not so much for content classes that also have a language teaching and language instruction component. But they said, I have to keep this. They feel so comfortable. Sometimes those voice threads could go on and on for 10, 15 minutes. Like, the responses were amazing. I just couldn't believe it. It's like, how is this is a short essay here. So I have to keep this. So now I've added this component, which is, it's an extra credit to see what would happen. And then instead of having for the 320 class for this survey, having them one activity friends I know use is having a book of, right, like some sort of diary, or it can be a blog, right, collecting quotations from the readings and then reflecting on them briefly. So I did that through VoiceThread, but only as an extra credit for whoever wanted to do it. And there have been a class of 20, that in 4 students who have been doing that and using the VoiceThread. The answers are not as spectacular as they were last year. They don't go on and on for 15 minutes. But they're good, and they're benefiting from them. So just two examples of things that have changed in my teaching that I would not have ever tried before. It was not part of how I saw what I would do in class or what my function was.
Thank you. Yeah, Megan?
I was just going to add that I think there's a parallel to be drawn to the way that we talk about lecture versus discussion as sort of the primary non-haptic modes of course instruction, where given the course, given the particular students, given the configuration, one makes more sense than the other. And it seems like there's two questions that we're facing right now and sort of thinking about the affordances of digital modes versus more traditional face-to-face modes. And the first of those is sort of, how do we build pedagogies that have the same kind of responsiveness and dynamism that we have in the classroom, where you can pause for discussion if half a dozen hands go up, or, you know, if you're talking about something. I mean, this came up when people were talking about sort of the need to I think, Arthur, you talked about kind of footnoting classes with your videos, which was a phrase I really liked. So figuring out how to adapt these new tools that we've become more comfortable with over the last 18 months so that we have the same degree of agility. And the second issue that seems key to me right now, and this gets back to your most recent comment in the chat, Jesse, is how do we make it clear that this is something for us to decide as faculty, responding to the needs of our students, furthering the goals of our classes, and that we mark this out as a space for instructor autonomy, whether that person is tenured, a graduate student, you know, non-tenure track faculty. I really strongly feel that when we move past pressing public health reasons for these, faculty really need to advocate for this as something we have a voice in and that we have autonomy over when it comes to our own classrooms and teaching practices.
Yes, yes. I'm glad we're getting to this point or this issue, because I think this one's especially important to me, which has to do with our own kind of pedagogical autonomy. You know, there are, as Miriam pointed out in an earlier session, a lot of forces that are trying to take advantage of this moment for their own purposes, which aren't necessarily in the best interests of our students or us, right? I know in my own university, I'm part of an active union contract negotiation where our administration is trying to redefine modalities of instruction so that they have more control over when we go remote and, you know, what kinds of compensation we may or may not receive for developing online courses. And workload seems to have been a common issue throughout all of these sessions. Like, we want to make our teaching more accessible. We do this because we believe in what we do. We want to help our students, right? But this is a lot of work, right? And to what degree are we going to be compensated for it? And even if we aren't, at what point is it so much that we burn out, like, or we can't do it, right? So, I mean, you know, how do we, respond to a lot of these kind of institutional and even beyond the institution, like, you know, within, you know, public discourse around online teaching and face-to-face teaching? You know, how are we able to kind of influence and really kind of emphasize our pedagogical autonomy as something that's going to be important for us and for our students? I think that's a really, for me, that's the question out of all of this. But I don't know, perhaps others at this point, I could ask this to people on the round table if they want to answer that question, but we're at the point where I think I could also open this up to anyone here in the audience that would like to offer their perspectives or offer a different question. Janine.
I just wanted to jump on that for a second, because I know that I think we as faculty also have to be very cognizant of those of us who are tenured or on the tenure track, very cognizant of those who are not. And I know at my institution, you know, we have full-time teaching associates who teach more, but don't have really service or professional responsibilities, right? They don't have to publish as much, at least. They have to be active. But I know during the pandemic, you know, these are the people who are in the trenches even more than we are in terms of teaching and have, you know, great pedagogical strategies and are very innovative. And, you know, institutions, or at least, you know, some institutions are tapping, you know, these people who are not tenured, not on the tenure track, to do presentations about teaching online and do all this service work when they're not getting compensated for it. It's not in their contract to do service, and they're getting paid terribly, and also, you know, have to teach more. So I think I just wanted to kind of give a shout out for those of us who are tenured or on the tenure track, that, you know, perhaps we could do more to advocate not only for ourselves, but for also people who might be taken advantage of because they're not tenured and they feel they have to say yes to everything that administrations want to ask them to do. So.
Absolutely. Thanks for that, Janine. Others or other questions from the general audience? I want to make sure we have plenty of time for those questions. Yes, Lydia?
Hi. I'm just curious, since we've been using it sort of this whole time today, I'm wondering if any of the roundtable participants have any reflections on like the role of the Zoom chat function or how people find that. I mean, personally, as a graduate student who is in coursework for part of the pandemic and is now teaching, and as like a millennial person, I find the chat one of the unexpected things that I came to enjoy about the Zoom class, just as a means of like temperature taking almost in the moment. And then also because it's, at least for me, so easy to become distracted by everything else happening when class is on the computer, the Zoom chat actually paradoxically is a way of keeping at least myself and other people engaged in the course instead of your attention wandering. So I'm just kind of wondering what other people think or other ways of bringing that kind of temperature taking or informal kind of subtext or sublayer into the IRL classroom.
Great question. Yeah, Arthur.
Yeah, this came up at a there was a version of this kind of conference or symposium at MIT that I was part of, and that question was the topic of a lot of discussion. And there was a huge range of perspectives and experiences with the usefulness or otherwise of Zoom chat. With some, I found it pretty useful along the lines that you articulated, Lydia. I found in particular students who were shy about talking would sometimes or actually often seemed to be more comfortable putting something in the chat, and it was a ready kind of thing to look to in that moment when one line of conversation seems to have led to a sort of played itself out. On the other hand, a lot of colleagues found it distracting in a bad way, and that, you know, there was sense was that students, no one, they couldn't really be sure that people were fully attending, and managing the chat became a thing. And so, you know, a lot of the MIT professors were like, well, we had our TAs do it. And those of us who don't have TAs were like, well, we don't have that option. So no answers except to say that everyone's mileage seems to vary radically. And it feels like another, to go back to the point about pandemic, the need for instructor-defined flexibility, that seems like one, that seems like yet another way to do it. I was considering having a question on my final course evaluations, because we can add questions as well as just whatever the standard ones are. Like, what would your version of Zoom chat be in an IRL classroom, and how could we think through that? And anyway, so.
Yeah, I also.
Sorry.
I was just gonna say, I am a fan of the chat too on Zoom. I found it to be really useful, especially for students. It just becomes another mode for engagement that we don't have in the classroom, though. I do think very differently about chat for faculty meetings. It's a very different, I have a very different opinion about the kinds of passive aggression that happens there. But within class, I seem to be all for it at this point. Sean?
I was just gonna, sorry to be contrary. I do think one of the things I'm thinking about is, we've talked a lot about hopefully one thing we've learned out of this as well is the whole notion of one size fits all is stupid. And I think that there's just so many different ways these things work. And I you know, we've talked about, or in the chat it's come up too, issues of gender disparity, issues of ableism, and all sorts of things that affect the different ways people experience the classroom on both sides of the table or the Zoom window. But I also think age too, and generational differences. I find for myself, this, since I'm not a digital native, you know, I wrote my MA thesis on a typewriter, right? So I'm not really a phone guy. And so I find in my own classes, like when I'm trying to teach a seminar in particular, I find chat to be, I can't manage it actually, because I want to be, even in Zoom, I'm trying to engage with the students. I'm trying to have something that's like a face-to-face interaction, an engagement where we're talking to each other and we're dealing with issues. And I just find the chat off, I found in my classes, the students who were, I don't hold it against them, they're having really great discussions, but they're just running on the side. It was like there was another class going on and I didn't have a TA or anything. So I didn't, and even if I had, it would have been like my TA was running a section in the middle of my class. So that was my feeling about it. I just found it to be extraordinarily distracting and difficult to know. Again, it's like, I'm not sure where I'm supposed to be looking. Am I supposed to be talking to my students or am I supposed to be looking over here? You know, I'm just not savvy enough, I guess. And I do think it has to be generational. I just don't have that kind of processing unit in my brain. I have an old CPU that doesn't really do that kind of multitasking well. And so, you know, I don't know. Unlike Alex, actually, I love chat during faculty meetings. Because I can have the discussions I actually want to have while all these more like this crap is going on, that I can just make snarky comments without having to do it like sotto voce and getting found out. So sorry to be snarky, but I like chat during faculty meetings.
Yeah, we're definitely very different on that one. By the way, just a quick side note between, I thought you all might find this interesting. I'll go to Eurydice's comment, but Sean and I found out a number of years ago, I think when we were co-organizing with Kathleen Kelly, a former NEMC, that we both came from the same hometown in Colorado. So we didn't know each other, but we also have very different opinions about chat. So that's not a-
But we also went to the same high school.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, Eurydice, sorry to sidetrack us there, but.
No. I just fully sympathize with Sean. I hated the chat thread. On the other hand, I realized how important it was for everyone to voice their concern, their enthusiasm, etc. So how do we replicate the chat in the actual classroom? When I enter the classroom, perhaps I spent 8 minutes checking on everyone, discussing how their week has been, etc. So at the end, they feel so happy and ready to address every single bloody reading I have given them or to look at objects that they told me this week, it's like being in a psychologist room. I said, great, this is what we want. So because I couldn't follow the chat online, what I was doing was just to scour screen after screen and check for facial expressions, see whether they had turned off or on their camera, and try to understand how, you know, they had woken up that particular morning. Are they okay to Zoom? So Sean, I'm fully with you.
Thank you, Eurydice. So I would like to, if there aren't other questions, I do have one other question I'm curious about, perhaps to kind of get us more towards closing the conference. And I'm thinking about the earlier question about where we asked, you know, how is your thinking about your subject or how has it changed over the course of the pandemic? And so I'm curious to know what people think the place of medieval studies is post-pandemic. Like how will the teaching of the Middle Ages change now that we kind of intimately share this post-plague affinity with this period? So I'd be curious to know specifically about like how you think medieval studies as a field that we teach will change or not change going forward. I was thinking in particular, I feel like I was especially provoked by Jesse's comments about Constantinople and thinking about the palimpsestic nature of that and how there's a new kind of elimination of Constantinople in his teaching. So I don't know if Jesse has thoughts, but that was one element that I was thinking about.
I'm happy to ramble more, but I'm also I'm also really curious about how especially colleagues in other fields think that things have changed. I mean, like as a historian, I study chronicles, and so I'm kind of constantly obsessed with the very idea of like the making of time. I try to not descend in sort of like radical constructionism, because that's just too much. But I think that as I tried to express, for me, it made me just actually confront the the ephemerality of the stuff that I am teaching. And again, like back to I think the point that Megan made that really touched me so much is just like what are we trying, or as Eurydice said, thinking about not necessarily content creation, but sort of conveying learning agility. Am I sort of reconstructing this past that I think I know in the minds of my students, or am I just sort of equipping them as learners in a certain way? And the material that I teach really is actually unimportant. Even as I, and I say that even thinking that I still find, I am a sort of dyed-in-the-wool medievalist, I still find the medieval material that we all work with to be radically provocative in so many ways that I think so many other periods are not, for reasons that I don't really know how to articulate. And realize it may just be that this is the stuff that I'm used to now. I find it just continually thought-provoking, to get students to think about things like, the class they teach that Sean mentioned, of the construction of the idea of the fall of Rome as a historical myth, and why does that persist? So for me, it's changed. It's made real. All of the things that were more sort of abstract ponderings about the nature of historical knowledge, it's made me actually kind of confront them pedagogically. So I'm curious if the sort of the lit people, Eurydice had these great comments about the sort of materiality of the stuff that you work with and have gone back to creating, so I'm curious if it's similar or different for people in other fields.
Arthur, did you want to respond to that?
Well, yeah, I don't know if it's field specific per se, but I do think going back to the comments about like the, living through a plague and then the medieval just feeling newly relevant to people who'd never really thought about it is useful. And I think gives us a real opportunity to seize however we best can. Down to, the incredibly lazy use of the word unprecedented, right? That we've constantly seen in news reports and stuff. That feels like an opportunity, a crisis and an opportunity to be cliched. So yeah, I totally agree.
Megan?
Just to follow on what was said, something that I feel like my students continually respond to in the literature that I teach is the way in which medieval writing tends not to be invested in covering up certain kinds of structures, certain kind of assumptions that later literature often kind of deliberately tries to obfuscate. And I think as our students, not only for COVID, but because of the climate crisis, because of uncertainty about what their professional lives are like, really that sort of uncertainty that I find permeating, I mean, Arthur's field and my field are basically the same 14th and 15th century British literature, that resonates with students. I'm very skeptical of the word relevant, but I do think in important structural ways, the literature of the past is very relevant to the concerns that are at the top of my students' minds.
Thank you, Megan.
I was also thinking that, to go back also to Jesse's comment, content and data are kings, So we keep them, right? They have to understand when Constantinople was founded, etc. But we should sell ourselves and our discipline, the Middle Ages better, and emphasize connections and relevance. So I have students who come and they study, I don't know, Middle Eastern studies, or they come from the Divinity School. A student see one thing on a gold dinar struck by Saladin, and another student sees something else on a gold imitative dinar struck by the Crusaders. I have students who come from China, and they're very much interested how a Byzantine coin becomes a Chinese adaptation so many thousands of miles east of Byzantium. So I think this is probably the most inclusive space for students to develop their own stories, because in many ways, even the Crusades were a period of encounters much more than the 21st century. So we have to sell better what we do.
Thank you. Janine.
I would just say briefly, just to add to all these really poignant and important points, I would just add also, we talked a little bit about, or at least in the chat, and a little bit about like accessibility issues and how, you know, that has changed. And I'm not sure, we have not talked though about diversity in terms of either racial or socioeconomic, you know, issues, like actually you brought up, Alex, because that was also challenging during the pandemic for some of our students, for sure. And so one of the, I don't know if this is because of the pandemic, but one of the things I know I'm trying to do more in terms of how I approach the Middle Ages, based, you know, going off what Aridici and what Megan said, is, you know, I'm trying to center my survey course now around the themes of race, gender, and class. And I use more accessible, but also scholarly things like the public medievalist thread on race in the Middle Ages and gender in the Middle Ages. I'm asking them to read some essays from that and talk about it theoretically before we dive into, you know, some more content-based stuff. So I feel that that is in some ways trying to encompass inclusivity in the classroom that maybe came more to my mind during the pandemic because of students who were, say, Zooming from their car or whatever. So
yes, I agree. I think that, I mean, it seems like it's been a common thread as well, that we've kind of not necessarily set aside, but bracketed and kind of critically questioned this notion of rigor in our teaching, in order to really try to make the most of the kinds of spaces that we could develop with students given the circumstances, right? So taking any moment we could to teach them, and even if that meant like setting aside deadlines and accepting, you know, projects late, or trying to Zoom in students who are in quarantine, or, you know, whatever it was to try to make it happen for students, right? It seemed like this moment, like, kind of compelled us to be as inclusive as possible. And that meant like developing more accessible platforms and pedagogies that would meet the needs of our students. And that seems to me like a good impulse. And like, I think it says, it speaks to, I find it really gratifying to see my colleagues doing this, because you see that that's kind of a baseline motivation for all of them that we share. And so perhaps I see that we're almost at 3 o'clock. And I probably want to conclude the session in the conference here soon, but are there any other final thoughts that people have or questions you want to pose before we finish up?
I just wanted to say, Alex, that I think that this accessibility and inclusivity issue is something that I really hope continues if/when we go back to in real life teaching, that awareness of students come into the classroom with very different levels of resources and the levels of accessibility that they need. I think it was able to be kind of a guiding principle for many of us because we didn't know what else to be guided by when we were going online in the first place. And I just hope that we can maintain that focus on student health when things go back to normal.
Yeah, could not agree more. Yes, maybe that's a good place to end, unless there are other comments.
I wanted to say one thing, which was this goes to some of the points Marian's been making about financial exigency, about the uses that I think the nefarious uses to which crisis can be put by institutions. And this whole, I think that idea that in a sense, the technology is a panacea that allows for, it's kind of like the robots coming to take over the factory. And I think that of course, administrators learn to their chagrin soon enough that that's not how it works. But you can't just have some tech that teaches the classes. It's not like Google Translate. You still need instructors. You still need knowledge. You still need all sorts of things. But I wanted to make a plea too that what we've learned about tech, I'm kind of hoping also can help us to broaden our notions of the teaching we do at our own institutions. And I'm thinking here in particular about cross-institutional collaboration. Because we now have tools that would really allow us. I've been wanting for a long time. I have a colleague in Britain, and I've really went and talked to her a lot. Said I'd love to teach a class, co-teach a class with somebody at a different place, maybe even in a different time zone. I don't know how it would work, but I feel like the tools are there now, and I think there's ways we can leverage what's already being put in place to do the things on our own campuses that will allow us to reach out to our colleagues at other campuses. And I think the more we can do that, I think it's paradoxically makes it harder to make the claim that, this could just be done by somebody else. In fact, it shows that no, it can't. It has to be, in fact, it really needs to be done by groups, that we work across our institutions and departments and are working together with one another and bringing our students together in new sorts of ways that I think could be really valuable. We've always valued study abroad, but this is a different way of thinking about that model. What would it be like to teach a class that was between Harvard and Colby? Or between Middlebury and Stanford, or whatever it might be. I think it could be really exciting. And I think there's real opportunities there in this moment. And I think I just want to put a plea out there for people to think about them and think about how they might be able to do them. It is a lot of work, but I think we've learned what it means to do a lot of, we've all agreed we're kind of suckers for doing lots of work. But I think it's a kind of work that could really value what we do in new sorts of ways and sort of put into practice the things Eurydice talked about, about networks, about globality, about the permeability of boundaries. I think there would be a way to put it in practice in the present day. So that's just something I wanted to throw out there.
Good point, Sean. And also it's probably a good opportunity for me to talk about already planned cross-institutional collaboration that has to do with future New England Medieval Conferences. Megan already mentioned that the 2022 conference will meet on October 8th at Colby College. And we're hoping it can be an in-person event at that point. And then soon after, in the spring of 2023, March 25th, we'll have the following New England Medieval Conference at the College of the Holy Cross. So a couple dates to put on your calendar and look forward to. And I really look forward to seeing you all in person soon. If not then, maybe at some other conference even sooner than that. And wish you all the best in the rest of your semester. And I want to thank you once again. Thank you to all of the panelists. And thank you to all of the audience members that have offered provocative questions here and in the chat and suggestions for resources. There's a lot of rich material here that I think is going to be great to have when we put it up on the Middle Ages for Educators website. So we'll be back in touch about that as well too. So once again, thank you very much. And greatly appreciate your willingness to be online on a fall day like this.
Thank you, Alex and Sean. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mary.